Hey there, guys. Well, I'm still out here, digging away. And lucky me, I just happened to find three more Land Before Time sequels. Let's start things off with The Land Before Time 4, Journey Through the Mists. I'm not really sure that Mists is something that you can devote an entire sequel to, but if these filmmakers thought that it would be okay, then I guess we're in good hands, aren't we?
Land Before Time 4. It's slightly more overcast than usual.
Oh hey, it doesn't open in space. Neat. Unfortunately, it still feels the need to open on a retelling of the history of early life on Earth.
Again. This is less neat.
Millions and millions of years ago, before there were countries or cities or states, before there were horses or bears or elephants,
before hockey pucks or Atari or pudding,
blah blah blah, life arising from harsh conditions, yada yada yada. We're introduced again to our dinosaur friends as they spot a herd of longnecks coming into the valley.
Grandma! Grandpa! A herd of longnecks are coming into our valley!
Yes, we saw them too, Littlefoot.
How did you see them coming?
They go to welcome the longnecks, but Grandpa has a little trouble.
Oh!
Grandpa!
Are you all right?
Strange, I suddenly felt so tired.
I wouldn't worry about it. It's just a head rush. I get him all the time.
A long neck with a head rush. That would be epic.
Alright, here we... Oh no, I stood up too fast!
They meet the leader of the herd, simply called the Old One, how original, and she has some questions about the valley.
Tell me, how is your climate?
Hey, hey, hey! That's personal, bub!
She's picky about where the herd will settle next, since the place they used to call home has been seeing some interesting changes of late.
Water fell from the sky for weeks on end. Our land grew wet and soggy. Strange creatures began to make their home on what was once dry land. Other creatures moved into the trees that were our source of food. The once green land we had migrated across for years had become the Land of Mists.
Damn you, overnight evolution!
While playing with his friends, Littlefoot bumps into one of the visitors.
Ow! Okay, Sarah. You asked for it.
Oh boy, here we go. Littlefoot gets a temporary love interest. We're entering fanfic territory here.
Hey, you're not Sarah. You're a long neck like me.
I'm Allie.
Allie? Allie's sister. Allie? Allie's sister! Oh, there she is!
Littlefoot introduces her to his friends, but she's afraid of them for reasons that are never explained. I mean, I know that a group of friends as diverse as this is kind of odd, but none of these kids were ever afraid of each other because of their differences. What's her deal?
Psst, Littlefoot! I'm over here!
Did you change your mind? Do you want to play with me and my friends?
Hey, Raven!
What are you doing? Are you having a seizure? I'm breaking up with you.
Aw.
After several hours of ditching his friends to play with his new piece of tail, who won't be appearing in any sequels after this one, he goes home to find that his grandpa has fallen ill. The Old One tells Littlefoot that only by eating the night flowers can Grandpa get better. And where are these night flowers? the Land of Mists, which means that no one will help him, naturally. Thanks for being so welcoming, Grandpa. We'd like to help you out, but... nah.
The land has changed too much. Long necks are not welcome there.
The Land of Mists is a dry county.
There has to be more I can do.
Littlefoot, we all must learn to accept what the Great Circle of Life hands us.
I think he's done enough accepting of what the Great Circle of Life hands him. I think the kid deserves a break! Cough, dead mother, cough!
Grandpa makes them promise that if he dies, Littlefoot and Grandma will leave with the other longnecks.
No.
Please try to understand, little one. There is nothing we can do. The Circle of Life is simple, yet profound. A quiet, straightforward line that goes around and round and round.
I'll just do you a favor and cut to the real Circle of Life song. You're welcome.
Littlefoot enlists the aid of Allie to get to the Land of Mists, and Allie is very insistent on Littlefoot not involving his friends. And Littlefoot just goes with it, never questioning why. Can't you take her out on at least one date before being whipped? Unfortunately, Allie isn't exactly as reliable a guide as Littlefoot thought.
My herd has moved so much, sometimes I lose track of where I am, or where I've been.
So at this point, all you can do is die, decay into oil, turn into a gas station, and then pull into it so you can ask someone for directions.
Allie leads Littlefoot into a cave that should in turn lead them to her old home, but they cause a rock slide that separates the two of them, so Allie has no choice but to go back to the Great Valley for help.
Allie? Allie? Are you out there? I've got to find another way out.
And seconds later... He meets a giant turtle named Archie, and no, I don't care what this ancient animal's scientific name is, it's a frickin' turtle, and he helps Littlefoot try to escape. Allie and company make it back, and I guess in the meantime, Allie was bitten by a radioactive spider? We then meet our villains, a Deinosuchus named Dill, and her seeing eye bird named Icky. And I looked into it, some bird species did exist that far back.
Icky, I'm hungry.
You're hungry? What about me? I do all the real work around here.
You? I get all the food.
Well, you couldn't get it without me. I'm the eyes.
So, I'm the teeth.
Who needs you?
And who needs you?
I need you like a hole in the head.
And I need you like a bug in the bed.
And so it begins. How do you know what a bed is? Could have easily said nest or bedding, but no, you said the word bed. How do you know what a bed is?
You're constantly by the claw that feeds you.
Who needs you, not me?
And of all the directions they could have taken this villain song, why did they make it sound like an upbeat Broadway showstopper? I'm almost expecting Nathan Lane and Matthew Broderick to start singing about fighting the worst play ever written.
So who needs you, except the race that breeds you? Who needs you? Not me.
Not me.
Not me.
Not me.
Not me.
After they're done singing about how much they don't need each other, they instantly go back to meeting each other as Icky leads Dill to Littlefoot and Archie.
Shh, quiet. It's one of the baby long necks. Something tells me supper is soon.
Why isn't it supper now?
After some cat and mouse with Littlefoot and Dill, his friends break through and save him.
How'd you know where to find me?
Allie came and got us. She did.
Thanks, Allie. I was afraid that maybe something bad happened to you. I'm sure glad you're okay.
Looking at.
They finally make their way out of the cave and into the Land of Mists when Sarah gets separated from the group. They run into a rat-like creature that Ducky decides to call Tickles, and he helps them find Sarah, but then she falls into the river and gets attacked by Dill. Just like with the sharp teeth before, I have to ask, is there really nothing more that she can eat?
I'm coming, Sarah!
Huh? And yes, I'm all for character arcs and all that, but this girl was terrified of Ducky. Where did she get the balls to face this monstrosity?
So you see, with my herd moving around so much, I never got to know anyone but other longnecks. But after everything that's happened, I know now that it's great to have all kinds of friends. In all shapes and sizes, too.
It takes all sorts to make a world. Short and tall sorts, large and small sorts. We need all types to make our way.
Tried and true types.
Me and you.
No, it's supposed to be tried and true types and brand new types as it focuses on Tickles. Just because the song is probably gonna suck, that's no excuse to not try. So now that they're out of danger, they resume their search for the Nightflowers.
When are we gonna get there? My feet hurt, and I'm hungry.
Then eat! You're surrounded by food! By the way, the area surrounding the Land of Mists was very rocky. When did they get to Kansas? But joy of joys, they found the Nightflowers! They take a bunch of them and start off for the Great Valley, but Dill and Icky have caught up with them again.
Ducky!
Me saying you, Ducky! Let go!
Wow. I had no idea that Ducky was that elastic. She's a rubber ducky. After all this time, we finally hear Spike talk, and it's because he's afraid for the life of his big sister, and you made him sound like Gilbert Gottfried! Oh my god, my big sister's going to die! Luckily, that little bit of what the f*** was enough to get Ducky to wake up, and she fights Dill off. I guess this movie should have been called The Land Before Time 4, The Land Before Physics. Now that they're out of harm's way, they bid goodbye to their little friend Tickles.
Do you think we'll ever see him again, Allie? I hope so. The land is changing. Maybe we'll all live together someday.
Nope, sorry, but spoiler alert, dinosaurs are doomed for extinction and mammals will dominate the Earth, baby! Woo!
We're home. Yeah, I hope my grandpa's still...
Oh, now you're gonna play the music from the death of Littlefoot's mom? That's not fair, movie! They give him the flowers, and he's soon back to his old self in no time, as if there was any doubt. Now that Allie has fulfilled her purpose and is now completely meaningless, it's time for her and her family to leave the valley.
Goodbye, Littlefoot. I know we'll meet again someday.
We've got 10 more sequels to milk out of this. I'm sure we'll meet again in at least one of them.
Thanks for being my friend, Sarah.
Oh.
Goodbye, Petrie. I'm gonna miss you a whole lot, too. I'll miss you and Spike, too, Ducky.
I think I'll miss you most of all.
And now it's time to have a montage to highlight all the times they had together. Okay, so they've only known each other for a day or so. And really all she was to him was a glorified tour guide who ended up almost getting him killed. We really don't know anything about her personality, except she comes from a very xenophobic herd. Okay, so this montage was just an excuse to cut corners on the animation. But man, is it necessary!
And so, it came to pass that the migrating dinosaurs left the Great Valley for lands unknown. And yes, Littlefoot and his friends Sarah, Ducky, Petrie, and Spike would indeed meet Allie again one day.
Spoiler alert.
But that's another story.
I have no idea why I'm focusing on a completely superfluous character returning when we should be focusing on how the only male authority figure in Littlefoot's life is making a miraculous recovery, but they will meet Allie again in another story. Hooray? And of all the things to end this movie with, they decided to focus on Grandpa Longneck's ass. Okay. Now that that's over and done with, time to talk about The Land Before Time 5, The Mysterious Island. Before the movie begins, we open on Universal's new non-cartoony logo. Might they be taking this franchise in a more mature direction? Not to give too much away, but no. And not only are we opening in space again, but we're seeing the creation of the galaxy? Sheesh, talk about a literal major step backwards. Our story begins with the kids bickering over who gets the last tree star on this one tree. Isn't the point of the Great Valley that they're surrounded by food? Just go to the next tree that's 5 feet away and eat from that!
The tree star's mine. Right, Spike? That tree star was ours! You mean it was mine?
And what happened between movies that turned Littlefoot into a little asshole? After Grandpa Longneck demonstrates how much of a waste of time all of that was, a swarm of locusts comes in and decimates the entire valley.
When the bright circle rose today, the Great Valley was a paradise. And now, the Great Night Circle looks down on a wasteland. I'm afraid it could be a long time before there's enough green food in our beloved valley to sustain us.
But it's okay, it shouldn't be that big of a problem. You guys have already survived a severe wildfire where most of the valley was decimated before, so how different can this be? The adults decide that their only course of action is to leave the Great Valley and find food elsewhere. This sends the kids into a panic since they think they'll be breaking up into separate herds again, but they're relieved when they're told that they'll still be herding together.
At first light, we leave the Great Valley. Together.
Together!
Okay, Petrie, go. Oh. But first, Petrie need help?
Help? Petrie forgot how Petrie's hands work!
Unfortunately, the narrator comes back to tell us how hard finding new food really is.
But though they marched day after day, they could find no such fertile paradise.
And when they couldn't find any water... It got so bad that the animators just stopped caring. The other sequels were keen on making their walk cycles the way they should have, following the pattern of back leg, front leg, back leg, front leg, but now they're just animating both legs moving at the same time. You're getting sloppy, animators. After it's apparent that nobody knows where they're going, Daddy Sarah splits away from the group.
We're splitting up. From now on, it's every herd for itself.
So much for that whole, we must work together thing that he learned from the third movie. Is this showing how hard it can be for someone to really have a change of heart, or is this just bad writing? Later that night, Petrie tells Ducky and Spike of a plan that Littlefoot has concocted, and... wait a minute. Is she sucking her thumb? So, not only were dinosaurs warm-blooded, but they also had mammary glands? Anyway, they go out to look for food on their own, making sure that they leave very obvious footprints so their parents will follow them. They eventually pick up the scent of nearby water, and follow it to where there must be some fresh green food.
Must be right over this hill!
And somewhere under the rainbow! All we have to do is follow the yellow brick road!
We can just hear the grown-ups now!
Yes!
My goodness! How in the world have you children finding so much?
Water?
I've never seen such big water in my whole life.
For some reason, I always figured that the Great Valley was somewhere in prehistoric California. I guess all this open desert right on the beach means that they're actually in the Middle East? They find that this big water isn't quite as drinkable as they thought it would be, and continue to walk to an island just off the coast, which has plenty of food on it. Later, it'll be revealed that they would have found more food, along with fresh water, if they just walked a mile or so up the beach, making me wonder why they never think of having Petrie just fly up a few hundred feet to scope out the surrounding area. Anyway, walking to the island is taking a little longer than they expected.
It's a lot farther away than it looks.
This is like waiting for your hatch day. It never seems to get any closer.
So how exactly did the dinosaurs figure out how to commemorate when they were hatched every 365 days? And the Lord said, "Yea, let tsunamis beat down on our heroes, and the skies and the seas shall change color in a dramatic fashion." They eventually get to the island safe and sound, but they're unsure about whether or not the plants are edible.
Let us ask Spike.
Yeah.
Spike!
How is it? You feel okay?
Totally missed opportunity here. Let's get Spike to try it. Spike eats everything. He likes it. Hey, Spikey! Meanwhile, the adults follow the kids' tracks, and while they're disappearing into the ocean is certainly ominous, Grandpa Longneck insists that they don't give up hope. Hey, Flyer, you want to try doing something?
Beep, 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 water.
Great, another song to fill up time. And by the way, does this sound like it belongs in a Land Before Time movie? It sounds more like something you'd hear playing in a bar somewhere.
Things could be swimming around under there, way down deep. Sharply teeth, oh, those sharply teeth. We wish the sun would fly up
and make the water dry up.
We'd like to say goodbye up
to that big water. Big water.
Special guest appearance by John Carpenter's The Thing?
You gotta be fucking kidding.
Looks like we're all sort of scared of the big water.
Yup, yup, yup.
It's not fair to ask one of us to try to cross it alone. If one of us goes, we all go.
That's stupid. The whole point of pushing the strength and diversity angle in the first movie is that some characters have abilities that others don't. There is no way that you could have killed the Sharptooth without Petrie's flying, Ducky swimming, or the exceptional strength of Sarah and Spike. Petrie flying across the big water is your best bet of getting home. You're a moron for not trying to use it out of a misplaced sense of fairness. Look at this. They try to get back to the mainland by riding on a log. Well, there you have it. The first invention was not the wheel, but the boat. And it was invented by dinosaurs. It won't be long before they learn how to use fire. Unfortunately, the big water has their own sharp teeth to threaten our heroes. Nice work there, Bassoon. Since ripping off James Horner wasn't enough, now it's time to rip off John Williams. They eventually evade the Megalodon, back to the island instead of the mainland, of course, by somehow launching themselves with their weak-ass paddling. Crap, I already used my Land Before Physics joke. It isn't long before they meet a familiar face.
Chomper?
Yep, it's me.
Yep, Chomper makes the scene, and he can talk. We don't know how much time has elapsed between each individual movie so far, but if, for the sake of argument, we place them back to back, only about a fortnight has passed. Apparently, dinosaurese is incredibly easy to learn. Anyway, Chomper insists that they meet his parents.
I know they'll like you.
How? Rare, medium, or well done?
You don't know what cooking is.
What's with you? This is Chomper, remember? We saved him from egg eaters.
Yeah, then he immediately tried to eat her. I think if anyone should be allowed to have reservations about trusting Chomper, it's Sarah! When Chomper's parents show up, we see them speaking in their own unique language. Okay, fine, I'll buy that. But how did Chomper even learn Herbivorian? If you really need an explanation as to why we never heard the sharp teeth talk before now, just have them talk to our main characters in plain English and have them explain that the constant roaring we heard before was simply an intimidation tactic. That would also explain why they look so monstrous in these earlier scenes, but not when they're reunited with their son. I thought the whole point of the end of movie 2 was that sharp teeth aren't that different from anyone else. I'm not going to question how his parents are supposed to believe that when you'd think that they would know what they're feeding their child, but what I want to know is why the sharp teeth relocated to this tiny island in the first place. How much food can there actually be on a little patch of land like this?
I know a place that they would never find you. It's a good thing my fox are the only big sharp teeth around here.
No, stop! We're not doing that! We're not doing that! We already had a Spinosaurus steal the T-Rex's thunder in Jurassic Park 3! We are not doing this here! Do you understand me?! Actually, this particular sharp tooth, according to the Land Before Time wiki, is a Gigantosaurus. Good, that's one less gray hair I have to deal with. Chomper leads his friends to safety, which apparently lies on the other end of this ravine.
I won't look down.
Check! I'm looking down! Ah!
He hides them in this patch of flowers, and he gathers some food for them.
Friends for dinner.
He just wants to have friends for dinner.
Hey, why am I singing in Ducky's voice?
Actually, no. This is Ducky's singing voice.
He would spit out Sarah, 'cause she's too tough.
Apparently, Littlefoot sounding like this is not the result of the editor mixing up their voices when putting all this together. This is supposed to be Littlefoot singing. Thanks for making him sound like a little girl, Mr. Director.
That's not a very nice thing to do,
to have friends for dinner.
Watch. Daddy Sharptooth is going to see Chopper gathering all these fruits and veggies, and he's going to say, "Boy, I better not see you turn into a gall-dang herbivore. I don't want to have to smack you." Called it! Oh my god, he actually said it! Am I even needed here? The movie's making fun of itself just fine.
Sure you won't have a bite?
Well, I...
Littlefoot, watch out!
No thanks. I gotta go.
Chopper! Hey, Chopper! Wait up!
Chopper, wait, please.
Look.
About what happened back there.
Don't worry, Littlefoot. You are what you are, and I am what I am. We can't change it, but we can still be friends. Can't we?
Of course we can.
I better get home. See you later.
So long, buddy.
Oh no! I bet somebody ate my last tree star.
I'm sorry, but how can we accept Littlefoot as the story's voice of tolerance and compassion when he's constantly irked over how his friends are eating his tree stars?
That tree star's gone. I'm gonna be really mad.
Eventually, the Gigantosaurus finds them again, and he corners them by the big water. Arr! I have delayed reaction syndrome too! Arr! Just when it appears our heroes are doomed, Chopper's parents come by to save them.
Tell me, do you bleed?
Surprisingly, yes. Something that bugs me about these sequels. Why are the T-Rexes outlined in black while these other characters are outlined in colors more befitting their own color scheme? It looks like the T-Rexes weren't supposed to be in this scene. But Chopper falls into the water, and Littlefoot dives in to rescue him.
Littlefoot! No!
You are not a swimmer!
You are a dumbass! Yep, yep, yep!
Littlefoot somehow knows to swim close to the island while the current takes the Gigantosaur out to sea. Because, of course, ocean currents are so strong that they'll just whisk away an animal like that, regardless of how many tons it weighs.
Hey! Whoa!
You children look tired. Can I give you a ride?
Why, of course. Plesiosaur equivalent of a stranger who goes up to a little kid and offers him some candy.
You want to know why they call me a plesiosaur?
Seriously, why do they have to draw her with come-hither eyes? And why do they give her flat teeth? According to the wiki, this character is an elasmosaurus, which, spoiler alert, is a sharp tooth!
Got some long-lost relations on the other side of the pond, as we say?
Yeah.
Well now, I might just be able to do something about that.
Really?
Step lively now, kiddies. Mustn't tarry.
Okay, her name is Elsie. She says things like other side of the pond and Terry, which sound pretty exclusive to the UK, but I could be wrong. It really sounds like they're making her out to be an ancestor of Nessie, the Loch Ness Monster. Could they really not give her a voice actress who could give her a Scottish accent? Chopper tries to get his friends to stay with him, but they need to say their goodbyes.
Thanks, Chopper, but we live in a whole different world, and we miss it.
Movie, please don't try to be the Fox and the Hound, okay? You're just embarrassing yourself.
Bye, Chomper. Thanks for everything.
Bye-bye, see you so long.
Enjoy your awkwardly drawn foreshortening. So she gets the kids back to their parents, who, I repeat, found ample amounts of food and water just by walking a little while up the beach. And then, hours later, they finally say thank you to Elsie. I was wondering when you were gonna notice me sitting here, you bastards. And since the return of the Great Valley was always just sort of implied, they didn't think it was necessary to actually feature it in the movie proper. Never mind the story potential that could come out of them being in a brand new environment, just throw them back into the Great Valley, that works. Now that the status quo has been reinstated, let's wrap up this review with The Land Before Time 6, The Secret of Saurus Rock. Once again, we open with the creation of the universe. Is every sequel just a complete reboot?
Since the very beginning of our world, there have been wonderful stories about how life began. There are tales of how the bright circle gave birth to the lesser lights of the dark time, which watch over us as we sleep, and many ways of explaining how our world itself was formed. And how the first strange, incredible creatures came to walk upon the land.
And God said, "Let there be retcons!" And there were retcons.
In all seriousness, I do like how this beginning of the universe story is being told by Grandpa Longneck, so at least it makes sense in context. And it's funny seeing them gathered around a volcanic vent, as if they're sitting around a campfire, without it being an actual campfire. These dinosaurs knowing how to use fire would be freaking stupid. But that has to be ruined with these new characters.
Ooh. Ooh. Oh, dang, Dina.
Tweety Hortus.
Was that English?
Hush, you two, or Auntie Sarah's gonna be upset.
Auntie Sarah? That opens up too many uncomfortable questions for me to get into right now. Grandpa tells them a story about when the Great Valley was first discovered, and it was soon set upon by the most ferocious sharp tooth that ever lived.
But then, just when the Longnecks thought all was lost, the lone dinosaur appeared on the horizon.
Hi-ho, Silver Scales, away!
The battle seemed to last for hours. It was a spectacle no one had ever seen before. A lone leaf-eater taking on a sharp tooth.
Yeah, because it's not like your daughter ever did anything that impressive. The lone dinosaur was triumphant as he just kind of nudged the sharp tooth off of a cliff. Didn't I tell you this was gonna be epic? After the sharp tooth was defeated and the lone dinosaur took his leave, this weird thing apparently happened.
Oh, so they called it Saurus Rock.
1. You should not know the word Saurus. If anything, you should be calling this Reptile Rock. 2. Why couldn't you make it look like the rock that looks like a long neck that was referenced in the first movie?
If anything ever happens to Saurus Rock, bad luck will descend upon the Great Valley.
Grandpa Longneck, are you filling these children's heads full of nonsense? And just before bedtime?
What?
Yeah, that's not my name for him. That's his actual name in the movie. So let's recap. We have Littlefoot, Grandma, Old One, the Lone Dinosaur, and now Grandpa Longneck. Longnecks suck at naming things. Later that night, Littlefoot has a dream where he defeats the Sharptooth since he is the Lone Dinosaur! The next morning, we get more hijinks with Sarah's sister nieces. Three horns can't climb trees. Either. Littlefoot proposes that they play the Lone Dinosaur, and Sarah takes on the crucial role of Sharptooth.
Now I have you.
No, please do not eat its mean old Sharptooth. Oh, no, no, no.
Yeah. Me too young to get it.
It? Apparently, Petrie comes from the deep south. Suddenly, the real, the Lone Dinosaur, shows up, much to everyone's surprise.
Welcome to the Great Valley. Welcome.
Just passing through.
Well, stay just as long as you want.
Hold on there. We don't know anything about this fellow. Who is he?
He's Kris Kristofferson. I know, I'm weirded out too. Of course, Littlefoot starts stalking the guy. I give you history's first fanboy.
Where'd you get that scar?
My daddy was a drinker. And a fiend. Later at the Hot Cocoa Springs?
Come on! Last one across is Sharptooth Bait!
Bubbles don't work like that! Or maybe this is a spring of liquid helium?
That's not supposed to be possible!
Littlefoot rejoins his friends and can't stop talking about the Lone Dinosaur.
Long ago, on a mountain top, a mighty egg was laid. Burned by the light of the circle bright and cooled by the forest shade.
Ugh. Again, why include songs if you didn't cast voice actors who could sing? This is just painful. Also, since they're clearly trying to evoke an Old West legend or the like, why not make everything sketchy and black and white? You know, make it look like an old daguerreotype or something. Maybe add fiery transitions like Bonanza while they're at it? I don't think making it look like South Park was the right way to go with this.
The Lone Dinosaur!
Yeah!
Later, they notice that the twins have gone missing, and they deduce where they could have gone.
Saurus Rock!
Thank you, and before time six, you made me hate the sound of children laughing. Does nothing in this universe have any sense of self-preservation? How are you two still alive? Just when you think the movie's going to offer us some mercy by throwing an Allosaurus at the twins, the poor thing gets stuck in a tree.
That sure didn't feel like a tree trunk.
It no look like tree trunk either.
And it does not sound like a tree trunk. No, no, no!
Ah!
You're stupid.
They get to Sorus Rock to find the twins on the top of it. How the hell do they get up there? After causing some irreparable damage to this natural landmark, as well as dealing with the Allosaurus, they get the twins down safe and sound.
What a day!
What a day!
Daddy Sarah finds them, and he is less than thrilled.
It was your duty to watch the twins, and you failed.
Yes, Daddy.
I am very disappointed in you. Now you march yourself right home.
Okay, either have an original musical score or don't.
I can't believe I'm actually saying this, but I think I really might prefer an original score to James Horner's, because this constant use of the dying mom music is getting old. You're making it lose its punch.
The next day, we see the dinosaurs having their own little bouts of bad luck, allegedly the results of Sorus Rock being damaged.
If the mountain starts to blow its top, that's bad luck. If the sky water falls and it just won't stop, that's bad luck. If your feet get caught in bubbly goo and you're stuck no matter what you do.
If a spike tail sits on top of you, that's bad luck.
Oh. So it's business as usual then.
Oh no! Where are the twins?
Better question. Where are their parents? Why is it up to Sarah and her dad to watch over them? Then from out of nowhere, a tornado starts up. Fun science fact, valleys are one of the places you'd expect tornadoes to happen the least. So, yeah, I guess Littlefoot really did bring bad luck to the Great Valley. It actually makes sense in its nonsensicalness. Ugh, I hate bringing up inconsistencies that only feed the plot. And in spite of tornadoes being very rare, the dinosaurs have a tornado bunker just in case?
Oh, Littlefoot!
Grandpa?
Oh, Littlefoot.
He saved me! Doc saved me! Again!
Grandpa, Littlefoot, thank goodness you're both safe.
Me never see swirling wind like that before.
Oh, no, no, no.
Sorry, Ozzy! Blowy, no, no!
Shut up! Why does every kid's movie think that every character smaller than a bread box has to be f***ing annoying? Yes, small children can have their irritating moments, but if everyone was this bad, there'd be no species!
It seems to me that we've suffered more than our share of misfortunes since a certain stranger came to the valley.
I agree with Threehorn here. Life was good in this valley, just fine. And then he shows up and everything falls apart.
That's right.
Our luck has turned.
It's the stranger's fault.
He's bad luck.
Doc is the bravest and the best long neck that ever was.
I never said he wasn't, Littlefoot. All I said was that he brought bad luck to the valley.
He didn't! He didn't! Well, I agree with my dad. I think Doc did cause all the bad luck.
We know who caused the bad luck, Sarah. And it wasn't Doc. It was us.
Look, I never liked the guy much, okay? And I'm not even sure I believe in this bad luck stuff. But if the grown-ups want to blame him, why not let him? Because it's not fair. They're going to end up chasing him away, and I don't want him to go.
Well, there's nothing you can do about it anyway.
Yes, there is. I can fix it.
So Littlefoot goes off to undo the harm that's been done to Sorus Rock.
I'm a lone dinosaur. I don't need anybody.
Gee, I wonder if all the other lone dinosaurs talk out loud to themselves like this.
No, that's just bad screenwriting. It happens when you're 6 movies into a direct-to-video franchise.
When you're on your own, life is so exciting. When you're on your own, the world is big and wide. You can do what you want and go where you like with just your shadow by your side.
And while this may be the most pointless song we've encountered yet, at least this voice actor actually carried this tune.
When you're on your own, you have to be the grown-up. 'Cause there's no one there to tell you what to do. But you miss your friends when daylight ends, and there's no one there to care for you. It's kind of lonely. when you're on your own. When you're on your own. On your own.
That was When You're on Your Own with Littlefoot. Now let's move on to something more upbeat here on the Light FM.
WLBT6!
Just one tooth. That's all I need. If I can get it back on Sora's rock, all the bad luck will end.
How is getting a tooth on Sora's rock supposed to fix it? If I tear a page out of a book, then replace it with a post-it note, that didn't fix anything. And why are you fighting so hard to get Doc to stay? You didn't make this kind of effort over Allie.
Boy, you remember how to get to Brokeback Mountain?
I guess so. But why do I have to know? You're gonna be with me.
Come on. You can do this. What's the big deal? It's just a big, dead shark tooth. Might as well be a pile of dirt. A big, smelly pile of dirt.
Wow. Littlefoot has a pretty morbid grasp on mortality, doesn't he? So yeah, he somehow figures that replacing this stalactite with an Allosaurus tooth will undo the damage and break the spell of bad luck that's fallen over the valley, and Grandpa Longneck is in hot pursuit to get Littlefoot back. Oh, come on! There's nothing even remotely sad happening!
This song is getting shade. It's losing all of its impact. Why do they use it repeatedly? They should just have left it alone for the dead mom.
Sadly, Littlefoot's attempts to get a tooth go about as bad as they can go, and the Allosaurus starts chasing him. Then a T-Rex shows up from out of nowhere. Again, it really feels like his inclusion was just an afterthought here. Grandpa Longneck does his best to fend them off, but he kinda sucks at it. Luckily, the lone dinosaur comes in to even the odds.
It's a good thing sharp teeth aren't very smart.
As predators, it's not like they'd have to think of strategies for hunting down their prey or anything. They're just a bunch of morons! By the way, Grandpa Longneck, you're only alive because of someone else coming by to save your ass. You can't really say you're smarter than the sharp teeth when all you're doing is relying on strength in numbers. So the sharp teeth are defeated. Littlefoot somehow gets a tooth despite their heads being buried in rocks, and because he has nothing left to do in the story, the lone dinosaur heads out yonder.
Time I was going, kid.
Yeah, but...
This herd life's not for me. Too much talking. Good luck, kid.
Doc! Don't go too far! You never know when we might need... a hero!
I know, right? I need a hero. I'm holding out for a hero until the end of the night.
I need a hero! I'm holding out for a hero till the end of the night. He's gotta be strong and he's gotta be fast and he's gotta be fresh from the fight. I need a hero! I'm holding out for a hero till the morning light.
He's gotta be fast and he's gotta be strong and he's gotta be fresh from...
Moving on.
You already got a hero, kid.
They put the tooth where it's supposed to go, I guess, which probably makes the bad luck go away, maybe.
Now, maybe the time of bad luck will finally be over.
Oh, Littlefoot, I told you. That was all just a bedtime story. There's no...
I know, there's no such thing as bad luck.
but there's no harm in making sure.
Oh yeah, no harm at all, except for the danger that you put yourself in, and your friends, your elderly grandfather, two toddlers. You're an idiot!
But there's no harm in making sure.
I can't even respond to how stupid that was. So, all's well that ends well, as we see Littlefoot giving his own spin on the legend of the Lone Dinosaur.
The Great Dinosaur!
I'm not going to describe how the Great Dinosaur looks like my grandpa, but trust me, this is a really sweet moment! So, that was The Land Before Time 4, 5, and 6. And I cannot be as kind to them as I was to their predecessors. I mentioned how the last few sequels were unnecessary, but at least they had a few lessons that one might take away from them. These sequels are only getting more and more pointless. It doesn't help that the animation is getting sloppier. None of the kids have their original voice actors anymore. The songs are forgettable at best, and earworms at worst. The plots are getting more ridiculous. And worst of all, I have this sickening feeling that because they're little and cute, the twins are going to start having more prominent roles in the sequels to come. But I guess we won't know about that until next week, when we delve into The Land Before Time's 7 through 10. See you later.
If the mountain starts to blow its top, that's bad luck. If the sky water falls and it just won't stop, that's bad luck. Ugh. If your feet get caught in bubbly goo and you're stuck no matter what you do.
If a spike tail sits on top of you,
if the log falls down when you cross the creek, that's bad luck.
Bad.
If a bee leaves a boo-boo on your beak, that's bad luck.
Bad luck.
If a big wind comes and blows and blows
and plops a rock right on your toes.
If a fuzzy bug flies up your nose,
that's bad luck.
Bad luck
when things go wrong and you feel just like you're cursed.
Bad luck.
It could get better.
Yeah, but it's gonna get worse. First,
when an earth shakes one chin up your home, that's bad luck.
Bad luck
when a shark tooth finds you all alone, that's bad luck.
Bad luck
when he chases you into the stream
and your mouth won't work when you try to scream
and stuck in the middle of a very scary dream.
Ah! That's bad luck.
Bad luck.
That's bad luck.
Bad luck.
It nurtures the young until they're fully grown.
And sometimes they fall to their deaths where they break every bone.
Subscribe.